Thank you. Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Is this microphone working? Okay. It's such a pleasure to be here. This is my second of two talks in 2 weeks on the theme of Occult America. And we had not originally planned on this being a two-part series, but the response was so overwhelming that we decided to split these evenings in two. So I'm very grateful to you all for being here. I'm also grateful to Ted Harris and to Catherine Walter, the librarian here, for bringing me into the Masonic Lodge. They have been such friends, and I'm very grateful. I wanted to say a quick word about this room. I'm very honored to be speaking here in the Gothic room. This is an active lodge room. The altar was removed, but you can see where the altar generally is placed on the tiled floor at the center of the room. And too frequently here in New York City, we're in such a hurry that we overlook our surroundings, but I really would like you to take a good look at this room. This is one of the greatest recreations of Gothic architecture that I think we have in Manhattan. If you take a look, the arched windows are crafted in such a way that they mirror each other from side to side of the room. The mirror effect was a very common device that was used in Gothic architecture. It creates both a feeling of openness and restfulness. And of course, you see the stained glass windows behind me here, how some of the early masters of the Gothic cathedrals in Europe created stained glass is still a matter of mystery and controversy. Their craft has never fully disclosed itself. If you look at the starred ceiling, that's also a common feature of Gothic architecture, the idea that this is supposed to be a cathedral to Providence, a cathedral to something higher. You don't want to feel boxed in, but you want to feel opened up. And of course, there's these adorable little troll-like figures etched in gold on the sconces along the perimeter of the room, also a very common feature of the Gothic. I would say probably the Catholic Church and Freemasonry are our two greatest connections to the advent of Gothic architecture, which really came into practice as the first reflowering of learned civilization and architecture after the fall of the Roman Empire, in some regards right at the tail end of the Roman Empire. So being in a room like this, even though quite clearly it's a recreation, albeit a very beautiful recreation, connects us in some ways to the spiritual imagination of people from late antiquity. And I think Freemasonry has been an extremely valuable vessel, in some regards, one of our only long-standing vessels that connects us to the idea of ancient ethics and the spiritual search as it was felt in past civilizations in our deep past, including Babylon, Egypt, Europe, Rome, Greece, Alexandria. Masonry has done so much to preserve the symbols, the rites, the rituals, and the idea of internal development as an exquisitely protected inner search, not a search that's part of any one doctrine or dogma or congregation, but that is a fundamental arterial part of the human experience in which every person from every background and every walk of life not only can experience, but possesses a birthright to experience. That was always part of Masonic ideals, and it has remained part of Masonic ideals in the 21st century. So it's very touching to me to be in a room whose architecture connects us to late antiquity. And the ideals of Masonry, I believe, are connected to the best ideals of late antiquity. The last lecture that we did, which was about 2 weeks ago, involved my looking at ways in which Masonry and other esoteric practices infused certain historical episodes and developments in early American life, and American life moving forward more towards the modern and industrial ages. We talked about the Masonic influence on abolitionism, particularly through the strain of Prince Hall Masonry. We talked about the existence of esoteric and Freemasonic ideals among many of the nation's founders. We talked about the development of the African-American magical tradition of hoodoo, which was really one of the first syncretic, radically ecumenical religious paths in American life, and it is with us still. It is with us still. We talked about how spiritualism and other occult and esoteric movements grew hand in hand with the movement of suffragism and women's rights, how many, in fact, the vast majority of early mediums at spiritualist seance tables and in spiritualist clubs were women, and how that gave women an unusual but very real opportunity to make their voices heard in the burgeoning religious and spiritual culture in America of the mid to late 19th century. In a very real sense, the occult is always present whenever there is some sort of historical usurpation and emancipation going on. Avant-garde religion and avant-garde or reformist, radically reformist politics have always grown from the same root system. When the individual begins to search, when the individual begins to ask in a deep, sustained, and mature way, who am I? How do I relate to the natural world? Why are these beautiful symbols so magnetic to me? Why do they feel like my special birthright? Once individuals begin to ask those questions, they cannot ultimately be kept down into some kind of servitude or oppressed by some kind of a political system that restricts their sense of selfhood. This is probably why the Chinese government was kind enough to remove large chunks out of my books as they were published in China. I was so excited at first when I heard, hey, your books are being translated into Mandarin, and then I heard, and hey, the government called today, and they're not really happy. But there's a reason for it. There's a reason why Freemasonry, for example, is oppressed in every nation that does not have some sort of a constitutional system, some sort of a system that guarantees the rights of individuals and minority members of society. Without exception, from Tsarist Russia to Saudi Arabia, Freemasonry has been suppressed and sometimes violently suppressed in every nation that would seek to abrogate the individual spiritual search. But our nation, in its best moments, has embraced and protected that search. It has also failed in terrible ways. And I pointed out last time that as all this religious freedom was flowering in America, generations of unspeakable slavery were playing out. The Native American culture was being destroyed, and the rights of women were extremely slow in coming. This is the irony of our society. And in every society, of course, one finds these frictions and the clashing of these tectonic plates between the rights and birthright of the individual for dignity, for self-expression, for individual search, and counterforces that seek to snuff out that flame and sometimes succeed in doing so. I wanted to dedicate this week's lecture to looking at specific personalities within American history, specific personalities without whom our world would be a grimmer place, and for whom certain occult episodes or encounters, or sometimes a lifelong occult search, played a vital, vital role. And you will rarely find these episodes in our history books, not because there's a conspiracy against them, or not because they've been suppressed, but because much of our intellectual class, like all of us to some greater or lesser degree, suffers from conformity. They learn about things, or they fail to learn about things when they're very young, and they never revisit them. They never revisit them. And I was astonished as I was researching my first book, Occult America, to find that there are so many figures in American life who we have a tendency to look at in very one-dimensional ways. As soon as a name becomes well known to us, whether it's George Washington or Harriet Tubman, as soon as that name becomes well known, that person almost becomes a one-dimensional portrait. We may admire the individual, we may venerate the individual, but we stop thinking about the individual. We stop asking, how did this person reach his or her sense of moral greatness or moral agency? One of the figures in particular that I was very surprised to discover had a pivotal, vital occult episode in his life when he was a very young man was the abolitionist hero Frederick Douglass. Now, you would think in a certain way that we know everything there is to know about Frederick Douglass. He wrote 3 memoirs. He's a widely known figure, although kids do not learn about him in school as they should. But nonetheless, he strikes us as a familiar figure. And that's where we have to take a yellow light. That's where we have to be very cautious. Because as soon as a compelling historical or moral figure starts seeming familiar, we shut down and we stop seeing that person in his or her full dimensions. Now, I too, before I began researching Occult America, I viewed Frederick Douglass as a great moral voice, a hero of abolitionism, and again, the man wrote 3 memoirs. So I said to myself, well, I probably get this guy. I probably get it. And I was wrong. I was shocked to discover that in each of Douglass's 3 memoirs, he tells a story that marks the central turning point of his life. Within that story is an occult episode that ties, oh, isn't that nice? I get a soundtrack. No, I like it. It's an occult episode that ties directly into the African-American tradition of magic called hoodoo, not voodoo, which is an Afro-Caribbean religion with which hoodoo is often confused. Hoodoo, hoodoo, with an H. Nobody is quite sure on the etymology of the word, on precisely where the word comes from. There's different possibilities. It seems to emanate possibly from West African religious traditions, where the term huduba means spirit, but no one has been able to fully settle on where the term hoodoo comes from precisely. But almost certainly it has its origins in West or Central African dialects. And it was a syncretic faith that was practiced by enslaved people who were desperately trying to hang on to traditions from the civilization that they had been torn from, but who also incorporated new ideas that they found even on the soil where they were enslaved. You'll find within hoodoo ideas from Kabbalah, Catholicism, German-American folklore, Pennsylvania folklore, all combined with different religious ideas and concepts, and a great deal of spell work and ritual and ceremony. I found it a hugely powerful path, which I approach with great, great veneration, and it's opened up a lot to me. Hoodoo is a living faith. It's still with us. Now, I was saying that I found this episode in all 3 of Frederick Douglass's memoirs, and it was an episode that was a leaf directly out of hoodoo. And yet, historians had never made this connection because they didn't know where to look. They weren't raised or educated to understand occult or esoteric or magical thought as something that any serious person should care about. So hidden in plain daylight, is this extraordinary episode in Douglass's life. And I'm pleased to say, and I'm honored to say, that having written about it, it's starting to be picked up in academia now for the first time. And I want you to hear this story very personally, because although Frederick Douglass was obviously writing about a certain time and place and brutality, because he was a great moralist, everything that he wrote also has a universal lesson. And there is a universal lesson in this story, and I'm gonna point to it, because I truly feel in my heart it can be of help to people. And I truly feel in my heart that there may even be people in this room tonight, in a certain sense, who have been waiting all their lives to hear this message. And it's not my message, it's a message from his life. But it must be highlighted, because I think he wrote it to be eternal in a way. He wrote it for human posterity, and it should be heard in all of its facets. Now, as some of you who are familiar with the life of Frederick Douglass are aware, in January of 1834, when he was 15 years old, he experienced truly the moral turning point of his life. And it was a moral turning point, ultimately, for our entire nation. He was born into slavery, and the brutality that he had to face is unspeakable. He was separated from his mother as an infant, and his mother, they were in the state of Maryland. His mother very often had to walk many, many miles just for the occasional privilege of rocking him to sleep at night, just for the occasional privilege of giving him a ginger cake or something like that. And you know, those of you who have kids, you're gonna go home tonight, you're gonna see your kids, or you'll see your kids, you know, sometime in the near future. You could just never imagine the agony that it must be to have to steal away time to see a child who himself is enslaved, and what he must have gone through as a very, very young boy being separated from his mother. You know, he grew up in an age, even an enslaved man, he grew up in an age where it wasn't easy for people, any people, to talk and write about their emotions. And it was a much more brutal time than ours. And you'll find in his work, as in the work of Booker T. Washington, there's a stoicism. He doesn't dwell very much on emotion, but any sensitive person in reading these stories, any sensitive person, would fall to his or her knees. And our nation, if I may say, our nation hasn't fallen to its knees yet. I don't feel we've ever come to terms with this period in our history. And so Douglass was raised in slavery, and he eventually, as a young man of 10, 11, was moved with the family that enslaved him to the city of Baltimore. And in the city of Baltimore, he was eventually able to teach himself to read. He got a little bit of help here and there. And then when his lessons were sort of brutally shut down, he would find scraps of paper, scraps of magazines, and you know, he was eventually able to put together his own literacy program. But then his family moved, or his captor family moved out of the city of Baltimore to the town of St. Michael's. And this was 1833, 1834. And they were concerned that Frederick, having spent several years in city life, albeit enslaved, would no longer demonstrate the obedience to work in the fields and so on. So they took a very brutal and desperate move. They bartered Frederick out to a sadistic, brutal figure named Edward Covey. And Covey had a reputation as the breaker of slaves. He was considered a very cruel taskmaster, sadistic man. Today we'd regard him as pathological. And the family thought that this was going to be the way of acclimating Frederick out of city life and back to rural or country life. And Frederick ran away back to his captor family, begged them to not force him to live on Covey's farm. They refused. They sent him back. He was punished brutally. And so the story goes that one day, at the age of 15, Frederick stood up to Covey, fought back, and the two of them, the 15-year-old and this sadistic slave master, struggled for a full 2 hours. And Covey was unable to get the better of Frederick. And so finally they relented, and Frederick said that he thought Covey was somewhat embarrassed, given his fearsome reputation, that he was unable to get the better of this 15-year-old boy. And he didn't tell anybody, and he sort of backed off from him a little bit. And Frederick said that this was the revolutionary moment of his life. This was the revolutionary moment of his life, because he had breathed in a sense of internal freedom. And he vowed that although he was still enslaved, he would separate from Covey internally. And at the first possible instant, he would separate from him physically and he would escape. And of course, historically, we know Frederick did, at the first possible instant, escape, came to the North, and developed into one of the most significant voices of abolitionism that our nation has known. Now, that's the standard story that you will hear repeated in classrooms, and that story is true. And I will come back to that story, but it is incomplete. It is incomplete. And if you want to find the full story, you must return back to Frederick's memoirs, where he told the full story 3 times over the course of his life. And our historians and our textbooks and our teachers have ignored exactly what Frederick said, because they just couldn't register it, because it has an occult backstory, and they were unable to place, to incorporate, or to understand the occult backstory. And here it is. In addition to everything I've just described, which is faithful to what Frederick wrote, he had another episode where he fled into the woods to try to escape Covey. This was before the episode that I just described. Frederick fled into the woods one night, 15-year-old boy, all alone in the forest. And a man comes upon him, a man he knew, a man named Sandy Jenkins. Sandy Jenkins. No child in school that I know of learns this name, but he's named in each of Frederick's memoirs. And Sandy was also an enslaved man. And Frederick said he knew Sandy from the area. He saw Sandy as kind of a wise man. He said Sandy was something of an ancient African medicine man. And the people in the area knew Sandy as this kind of wise man steeped in the old ways. And Sandy took him, and he cleaned him up, and he gave him something to eat. And Sandy said, "Listen to me. You've got to go back to Covey's farm." And Frederick said, "I can't do that. If I go back to that man's farm, he is going to kill me." And Sandy said, "Listen to me. I'm going to give you an object that's going to protect you. And if you hold this object on your body, if you keep this object in your pocket, not Sandy or any white man will be able to hurt you." And even at the age of 15, Frederick was skeptical. And Frederick writes that Sandy gave him an object, a hard, spherical, nub-like root to keep in his pocket, which Sandy vowed would give him indestructibility. Now, for those of you who are familiar with hoodoo, you probably know the route that I'm talking about, John the Conqueror. John the Conqueror. It's probably Jalap root. It's a hard spherical root that is one of the most venerated objects within hoodoo. It's like a dried nub, almost like a small walnut. And some say that it's meant to represent like a testicle, like a natural botanical version of a testicle. It's very hard. It dries as hard as a rock. And it's said that if you keep it in your pocket, you will be granted powers of virility, strength, indestructibility. There is virtually no question in my mind that this is the object that Sandy gave to Frederick. But since so little has been written and published about hoodoo within our culture, certainly within the decades that Frederick became sort of written into the culture, most historians just completely overlooked this. And frankly, they probably weren't very interested. Conformity quickly leads to boredom, because conformity stifles questioning. It stifles the search. So it's easy to see how people who don't pause and consider occult history, esoteric history, might read an episode like that and just not be interested at all. They're not trying to suppress it. It just doesn't, they're not well-rounded. It doesn't fit into their perspective, even well enough to ask, what's going on there? So, Sandy gives Frederick this hard spherical nub, which I'm all but certain is John the Conqueror root. Frederick places it in his pocket, and he said, well, what was I supposed to do? You know, this African wise man, he's given me this root. He's my only friend. He's my only helper. He's telling me I have to go back. So I went back. And he writes, he goes back, and it's a Sunday, and Covey is downright polite to him. And Frederick thinks, maybe Sandy was cracked. You know, and he can't believe it. But then comes Monday morning, and he realizes that Covey is only a Sunday Christian. He was just being nice to him because it was the Lord's day of rest. And then, come Monday morning, the old Covey is back. And he grabs Frederick and goes to beat him with a switch. And this is when they struggle for 2 hours. But Covey, for 2 hours, cannot get the better of him. And finally lets him go. And in each one of his memoirs, Frederick says, you know, I could never fully bring myself to come around to Sandy Jenkins' way of magic. But I had to say, it was a very, very strange episode. And I wondered if a ray of Sandy's superstition, as he put it, had not also fallen on me. And he said, in any case, I've never forgotten it. And if there wasn't some magical power in the root that Sandy gave me, the gift itself might have imbued me with some kind of courage that allowed me to do something I otherwise never would have done. But again, he said, and he makes this very clear in his first memoir, I thought perhaps a ray of his belief system had fallen on me. Now, it was very important to Douglas that his readers, particularly his African American readers, pursue the kind of self-education that he had pursued. He was skeptical of past systems, old ways of thinking. He was a free thinker. He was not an explicitly religious person, especially how could you be religious after meeting Edward Covey? But he never shied away from telling the story. And he was very clear, especially in his first memoir, especially. He plays it down a little bit in his second and third. But he was very explicit about saying that he thought there might have been something there. And the episode was vital enough to him, was vital enough to Frederick, so that he repeated it in all three of his memoirs, and it served as the threshold of an episode that was the most vital turning point of his life and was in many regards the most vital turning point of American life, of American life. And it started with one individual who prior to this episode had been counseled by Sandy Jenkins, a wise African medicine man, as Frederick put it. Why don't kids know the name Sandy Jenkins? They should. They should. I want to return to something in Frederick's story, and I want to say this to you very, very carefully, because, again, I have to be very clear. We can't just clip and paste chapters of history and apply them to our own lives. He experienced a level of brutality that few people in the 21st century could relate to, some less so than others. However, because he was a great moral voice, I do think in my heart, there's also a universal lesson in his story that people everywhere, from every place and time, can benefit. And I wanna call it out, because as I said earlier, I feel there may be someone or some more than one person in this room who maybe has been waiting to hear this all of his or her life. One of the things I talk about in my most recent book, The Miracle Club, which is a very practical book. I've always written as a believing historian, but this is not a work of historicism. It's a practical book. One of the things I counsel people is that we don't talk enough. We complain about everything, but we always complain about the wrong things. We don't talk enough in the 21st century about the problem of cruelty, the problem of being around cruel people. And when I meet somebody who's depressed or who's suffering or who's in some kind of need, and I'm in a position to offer any kind of counsel to that person at all, I always ask, do you feel perhaps like you're surrounded by cruel people? Are there cruel people in your life who you really ought to get away from? This is not a bad question to ask on the eve of Thanksgiving. Let's face it, Thanksgiving can be one of the most stressful holidays of the year. I mean, it's awful, you know, you gotta listen to your, you know, horrible uncle rant and rave about something. And if you have a peaceful Thanksgiving, you know, invite me over, because I haven't had one ever. And so, you know, but I often feel that we are in proximity sometimes to cruel people, a boss, a family member, a so-called friend,
president.
A president, yeah. And I feel very, very strongly that you should cut ties with cruel people and burn your bridges behind you. And I don't care who it is. You know, a woman in my neighborhood was telling me, oh, well, imagine this. She had a cruel mother-in-law, unprecedented. And she was telling me, you know, the burdens that her mother-in-law placed on her. And I said, why not? You know, even if just as a moral experiment, cut all ties with her. And she said, well, you know, I got a kid and I want him to grow up around relatives. And my view, just speaking personally, was, look, you know, your kid has lots of wonderful relationships, knows lots of adults who can serve as role models, has other relatives. If somebody is really cruel, at least take account of the fact that you have the option. You have the option of cutting ties with that person. And I mean cutting. You have that option. But very often people say, and they're right, I can't do that. It's an immediate family member, or it's my boss, or I have financial needs. And those are serious, serious things. And that's where I come back to the lesson of Frederick Douglass. Notice what Frederick did at the age of 15, the moral greatness he had at the age of 15. He made the resolve, and you can read about this in his own books, to separate from Covey internally. And he vowed to himself that at the first possible moment, he would separate physically. and he did. That vow is open to you privately. You don't have to talk to anybody about it. You don't have to ask anybody for their approval. You don't have to vet it with anybody. It's your birthright, as it was Frederick's, in unspeakably brutal conditions. You can make the vow internally, if you so need to separate from a cruel person within, and at the first possible moment, separate physically. I feel like there's great, great universal application of Frederick's story, as well as important history, and I always recommend it to people who are depressed or who are suffering from anxiety, and it seems to be situationally based. Isn't it wonderful, isn't it extraordinary that we have new things to learn about people who we thought were familiar to us? So here's this vital occult episode in the life of Frederick Douglass just prior to his having a turning point that helps to redeem an entire nation. It's extraordinary. And kids think history is boring because we don't teach them about it the right way. We take them to a Shaker village and say, well, here's a chair, and here's a broom, and here's an envelope of seeds. But we don't tell them about the greatness of these people and their search. I want to fast forward to another figure who was a great emancipatory figure in American history. And I want to briefly tell his story. And his name was Vice President Henry Wallace. He was the second vice president to Franklin Roosevelt, following a Texas congressman named John Nance Garner, and preceding a much more famous vice president by the name of Harry Truman. Brother Harry Truman. And Henry Wallace himself was a Freemason. Guess what number vice president he was in our nation's history? 33rd, our 33rd vice president. Can't make this up. Henry Wallace was an extraordinary figure whose name is obscure today. He was followed by Harry Truman, whose name obviously, for many good and varied reasons, is a household name, but no one, or very few, remember Henry Wallace. And yet, he was a figure who, in the 20th century, I think embodied the best ideals of Freemasonry and occultism, And when Alex Jones or any of the people who blow around the internet like to talk about occult conspiracies or the Illuminati or secret Freemasonic temples hidden under the White House, I wish, they of course overlook that which is more fascinating and more extraordinary than anything fantasy could conjure up, because it's absolutely true. It's absolutely true. It's a secret history, it's an occult history, and again, as with Frederick, it's hidden in plain daylight. Hidden in plain daylight. But it is neglected, if not rejected, because it doesn't fit the paradigm of thinking possessed by people who write most of our history books, possessed of people who write most of our journalism. I was speaking about this last week in our previous lecture about the life and influence of Mahatma Gandhi, how Gandhi had all kinds of occult influences that he wrote and spoke about from when he was young up through the year of his assassination, and yet this almost always gets written out of biographies of Gandhi because it's uninteresting. It doesn't fit. It doesn't comport with the worldview of people who come up through our academic and journalistic institutions. Now, Henry Wallace, one of the most remarkable figures in modern American history, he doesn't fit. Time magazine, in its infinite wisdom, did a list online, everything has to be a list these days, of 10 worst vice presidents ever. I don't know who comes up with these things at lunch. 10 worst vice presidents ever. And Henry was listed as number one. Probably written by an intern who doesn't know the first thing about Henry Wallace? Well, here's the first thing about Henry Wallace. He was one of the greatest intellects and most forward-looking visionaries ever to occupy the position of the vice presidency and to be in a president's cabinet. He probably did more for this country in terms of its agricultural development and its ideals, its diplomacy, its sense of moral purpose on the world stage than any other vice president in history. But you won't read that in Time magazine. This is the real Henry Wallace, Freemason. He was born to a family of farmers and scientific agriculturalists in Iowa in 1888. When he was a boy, the great African-American botanist and scientific agriculturalist George Washington Carver lived with the family. Because George Washington Carver was attending agricultural school at Iowa State, and the dormitories were segregated, so he had nowhere to live. So the Wallace family, always a good family, took him in. And Henry grew up with George Washington Carver until he was about 8 years old. And they would go for walks in the woods, and they would talk about different plant strains and hybrid plants and things of that nature. Henry's background was one of agricultural farming, but also politics. His father was a Republican and was the Secretary of Agriculture in the administration of Warren Harding. As Henry got older, he took over the family farming magazine, Wallace's Farmer. And he developed very early in life a kind of heartland occultism. Farmer's almanacs back in the day, and this is still true today, and you'll even find it in the Farmer's Almanac that you can purchase, you know, off the shelf at Walgreens or what have you. They have always featured zodiac and astrological ephemerae and information, because farmers going back countless generations in America and obviously in other parts of the world have planted by the cycles of the moon. And Wallace took very seriously the fact that it might be possible to come up with a scientific model, a grid, of the most advantageous times of year to plant according to the cycles of the zodiac. So Wallace's Farmer magazine, as with the Farmer's Almanac today, had zodiac and astrological information in it. It was a topic that he was always interested in. When he was a young man growing up in Iowa, later moving to Des Moines, he got very interested in Theosophy, the great occult movement that was begun by Colonel Henry Steele Olcott, a Freemason and a retired Civil War colonel, and his compatriot, Madame H.P. Blavatsky, a Russian world traveler transplanted to New York City. Henry became active in the Theosophical Society when he was in his early 30s. He joined a movement called the Liberal Catholic Church, which was a radically ecumenical Christian movement that grew out of Theosophy. He was interested in Native American mysticism and lore, including reincarnation. He took a very serious interest in Buddhism, particularly Tibetan Buddhism, when he was a very young man. He was very interested in the concept of karma. He read a book that some of you may know, In Tune with the Infinite by Ralph Waldo Trine, one of the great early books of New Thought and Mind Power, the topic that I explore in the Miracle Club. And this book was a huge influence on Henry when he was a young man. And he brought all of his ideas into Wallace's Farmer magazine. When Franklin Roosevelt was elected president, he invited Henry out to his estate in Dutchess County for a getting to know you session. Roosevelt liked the idea that Henry was a Republican. He wanted to demonstrate that his administration was politically broad-ranging. And he was very aware, of course, that Henry's father had been the Secretary of Agriculture in the Warren Harding administration. And in 1933, he asked Henry, still relatively young, to join his administration as Secretary of Agriculture. There was some resistance to this because Henry was a Republican. But the appointment went through, and Henry very quickly became the most significant Secretary of Agriculture in our nation's history. At this time in 1933, more than 25%, probably about 30% of Americans were still living on farms. It was still very heavily an agricultural nation. And farmers took a devastating hit with the onset of the Great Depression. Henry instituted reforms in American farming life that saved thousands of family farms. These included things like introducing high-yield seed, crop rotation, soil rotation, cutting overproduction, both of crops and of meats, particularly pork, thereby raising prices that had been suppressed by things flooding the market. There is almost no question that Henry's reforms saved American agriculture in the early years of the New Deal. And these same reforms were later exported to Latin America. And in nations that had gone through actual famines on our own continent, boom and bust cycles in which agriculture would crash and there wouldn't be sufficient food to go around, Henry's reforms saved countless, countless lives. This was the man named Worst Vice President in American History by Time Magazine. As Secretary of Agriculture, Henry not only was a really substantial presence on the American economic scene, but he eventually joined the Democratic Party and became an evangelist for the New Deal. And he traveled around the nation and demonstrated the capacity to speak to disparate communities that made up the New Deal, from black voters or people who were struggling to vote living in the South, to trade unionists in the North, to students and intellectuals. He seemed to be able to speak to everyone. He could communicate with everyone. He had that gift. And Franklin Roosevelt decided, when he pursued his third term, going into 1940, that he wanted Henry to be his vice president. His previous vice president, John Nance Garner, had opposed Roosevelt seeking a third term. So he picked Henry. And people came to Roosevelt and said, "You can't do this. He's a mystic. He's a theosophist. He's into astrology, reincarnation. He's just too weird." And Roosevelt, according to the Postmaster General, who was in one of the meetings, said, "He's not weird. He's a mystic. He's a philosopher. He's a digger. He's a thinker. He'll help the people think." Now, can you imagine a president today saying, "He'll help the people think"? Can you fathom that phrase passing Trump's lips, or it even occurring to him? I can't. But it was a different time. And despite the opposition, Roosevelt got his way, and Henry became his second vice president. But there were storm clouds on the horizon, and they eventually engulfed Henry. And this is what the storm clouds were. There was a very formidable and appealing and attractive figure in New York at the time, who some of you may have heard of. Maybe some of you have even visited his museum on the Upper West Side, and that is the artist Nicholas Roerich. Has anyone been to the Nicholas Roerich Museum on the Upper West Side? Great. Nicholas Roerich was a theosophist, a mystic, an artist, an experimenter, a man of Russian descent who relocated for a time to America, and there was almost no one like him. He was sort of like Madame Blavatsky from more than a generation earlier. He was a great grand experimenter who was looking for ways to combine the mystical philosophies of the East and the West. He was very dedicated to the ideas of theosophy. When Franklin Roosevelt was governor of New York State in 1929, he met with Nicholas Roerich, and Henry Wallace, around that same time, started meeting with Nicholas Roerich, and this was a turning point in Henry's life. Henry felt he had discovered a real guru, a real teacher in Nicholas Roerich. And for those of you who have been to the Roerich Museum, you can see why. He really was a remarkable man. He was a remarkable artist. He had this capacity to paint the landscapes and capture the architecture of both Eastern and Western holy sites. And in his hands as an artist, a Gothic cathedral and a Tibetan monastery could somehow look the same. The outlines of the buildings were different, but the way that he captured the light and the tones and the colors, his paintings alone gave you a sense that the searches of people from disparate parts of the world could converge. And that was only one aspect of Rorick's work. He was a set designer, he was a writer, he introduced his own brand of yoga into the West. He was really a remarkable person. Now, here's an interesting bit of New York history. On Riverside Drive, I believe it's at 99th Street, correct me if I'm wrong, and somebody else knows otherwise, but it's still standing. There's a building called the Master Building, the Master Apartments, that Nicholas Rorick built. Why did he call them the Master Apartments? Because he believed in a teaching that somehow, that was distantly connected to things that Madame Blavatsky taught, that a world teacher, a master, a messianic world teacher capable of uniting all the different religious faiths would come in our time. And when he arrived, when this world teacher, when he or she arrived, this world teacher, this master, would occupy the utmost part of this Art Deco skyscraper that Rorick had built on the Upper West Side, which is still there on Riverside Drive, the Master Apartments, the Master Apartments. The building bears Rorick's symbol. It was a pyramid composed of three spheres, three circles. Rorick had created a treaty, basically, that he was campaigning for different nations of the world to sign. And the treaty was one of cultural preservation, that if you flew this pyramidic flag composed of three spheres on top of art museums or cultural facilities, these things would be off limits to anybody who was engaged in warfare. They would be spared from bombing, they would be spared from enemy occupation. And at the height of Henry Wallace's career and influence in 1935, he was designated by Franklin Roosevelt to sign this Rorick Pact, this Rorick Treaty, preserving cultural treasures and places of cultural gravity. At the White House, in a ceremony with about 22 leaders from Latin America who also signed it, with Franklin Roosevelt looking on. This was the kind of influence that Nicholas Rorick had. However, he and Henry later squabbled very seriously over an agricultural mission that Henry had sent Rorick and his son on to Eurasia. And Rorick, while he was in Eurasia, which is to say the borderlands of Mongolia, Russia, China, he kind of went rogue. He picked up a band of Cossacks, and he and his son were traveling around all these border regions of China, Mongolia, Russia, areas that were also occupied by Japan, and no one quite knew why. And different Russian and Japanese and Chinese authorities were getting very nervous about, why is this mystic in robes traveling around with this armed band of Cossacks crisscrossing throughout our borderlands? It was rumored that he was looking for the lost holy city of Shambhala, the title of one of Nicholas Rorick's books. And this became a huge embarrassment to Henry Wallace. And Henry ordered the mission to an end. The point of the mission was supposed to be to bring back drought-resistant strains of grass. Who wants to do that when you can look for Shambhala? So things went badly. So Henry canceled the mission, cut ties with Rorick, demanded that he and his son come back, and separated from him completely. Unfortunately for Henry, he had written some very adoring letters to Nicholas Rorick that addressed him as dear guru and that used a lot of very flowery language. And these letters began to leak out to the press. They leaked out probably at the hands of disgruntled followers of Nicholas Rorick. It was wrong. These were private letters between a student and a guru, and they should have been kept private. if you want to do one thing to improve your life, don't violate other people's privacy. I think there are a few things worse than violating other people's privacy, even if you have a terrible dispute with that person. So Henry's privacy was violated, and these letters got leaked to a smirking right-wing columnist named Westbrook Pegler. Anybody know the name Westbrook Pegler? He's not widely remembered today, but he was a columnist for the Hearst newspaper syndicate. He was very, very widely read, and he hated Henry, and he began to leak out these letters. The White House was able to put a cap on it for a while, but it was always there in the background like a storm cloud. When Roosevelt ran for his fourth term, there were different conservative forces who were really marshaled against Henry, and they more or less persuaded Roosevelt to back off from his support. And at the Democratic Convention, Henry was deposed and was replaced by Vice President Harry Truman. And after the convention was over, Harry Truman, according to witnesses, approached Henry and asked him, "Can we still be friends?" And Henry said to him, "Harry, we are both Masons." I thought that was a nice piece of history. So Henry was deposed, but he became the Secretary of Commerce. That was his consolation job. After Roosevelt died, Truman wanted to clean house and bring in his own people, and Henry was pushed out. Henry reemerged in 1948 to run for president on the ticket of the Progressive Party. It was a protest candidacy that he was waging against Truman, who he felt was rolling back certain principles of the New Deal. And this is where his occult search really put an end to his political career. And this is what happened. These letters continued to drip out, and Henry would never acknowledge having written them. He was given by Rurik an initiatory name, Galahad. Galahad. So the letters were signed Galahad, and they were filled with very flowery, very mystical language. It was almost like, I think, his relationship with Nicholas Rurik gave Henry a kind of opportunity to reclaim the idealism of his youth. He was a seeker. He was a mystic. He was a theosophist. He was a searcher. And I think that there was something about the relationship with Rurik that gave him a sense that he found the teacher in adulthood that he had never found when he was a kid. And so he did use a very adoring language and a very flowery language. And it was embarrassing. It was embarrassing, especially at that time. And Westbrook Pegler, this right-wing columnist, would just go after Henry week after week after week. And this all came to a head in 1948 at a press conference in Philadelphia. And Westbrook Pegler was there, and he confronted Henry Wallace, and he said, "You know, I've been publishing these letters, and I will continue to publish these letters, and you have been dodging my questions, and I'm asking you, Mr. Vice President, did you write these letters?" And Henry said, "I don't take questions from Westbrook Pegler." And he wouldn't answer. And then the legendary journalist H.L. Mencken was also there. And Mencken stood up and he said, "Now, Mr. Vice President, you know I'm no Westbrook Pegler." And, you know, things began to calm down a little bit. And Henry said, "You know, Mr. Mencken, nobody would accuse you of being Westbrook Pegler." And he said, "Now, sir, nonetheless, you know, I do have to ask you, this is a question of public record, did you write those letters?" And Henry stiffened up and said, "I don't take questions on behalf of Westbrook Pegler." And he wouldn't answer. And that was it. You know, that was it. It was sealed. And Henry went on and won only about 2.5% of the vote in that election. Now, there were other reasons why his popularity plummeted, but it was very difficult for him. It was very difficult for his wife. I mean, years earlier, he had been at the pinnacle of power, and he was thought to be a person who could even replace Roosevelt someday. And had he remained in office, he would have replaced Roosevelt. Now, mind you, there are many reasons why Henry's candidacy crashed, and I'm touching on only one of them. but that was a very substantial reason. And life was very, very difficult for him after that. He and his wife moved to an experimental farm in northern Westchester County called Farview, and he lived there until his death in 1965. And he spent many years after that, a very private man, a somewhat damaged man, a somewhat hurt man. But he told a interviewer just a few years prior to his death that he believed that ultimately life in its various discursive ways, in its joys and tragedies, somehow evened out. And he thought that we did, even within the space of our own lifetime, experience some conception of karma. And he said to the reporter that was something that he learned in Theosophy, and he was eternally grateful to the Theosophists for that. So even in his later years, Henry never renounced his search. There were so many things that I think he contributed to American life, the greatest of which and the most material of which was this vast and absolutely necessary improvement in agriculture, which saved family farms in our country and God knows how many lives in Latin America where his methods were used. His signing of the Rorick Pact was an early effort to try to establish the idea that there was a shared set of cultural and religious values around the world. He made efforts, not always successfully, for minimum wage, for labor law reforms, for a code of fair treatment among foreign workers who were employed in America's munitions industry. The entire purpose of his political life was not only one of effectiveness, but one of unity. He believed in a great sense of unity, and I believe with certainty that he derived that from his own occult and esoteric search. The same search which ultimately undid his career. And I think if Henry had any flaw, his flaw was that he was unable to see. He was unable to see that others could not and would not bring themselves to understand the seriousness of his own search. He thought, because he was searching as a serious, mature person, he could somehow communicate that to other people. And that was unfortunately not true. And yet, as I look back on Henry's life today, the thing that inspires me is not his downfall, but his rise. And his rise, while never being embarrassed by or concealing anything about his occult and esoteric search. He would have been a more successful and more mediocre person if he had done the ordinary thing, if he had done the clever thing and concealed his search. But it occurred to me recently, as it even occurs to me right now, that one of the great inspirations that I take from Henry's life, and another thing that I think he bequeathed to each of us as individuals, and certainly something that I feel within my own heart, is never to conceal your search. Never to be made ashamed of your search. Never to feel that you have to hide behind convention or to be hedging or to be clever about your own search. That was never part of Henry's life. And that, among all his other accomplishments, was his greatness. And I've only been able to introduce you to two of these wonderful occult Americans tonight, but I hope that you will find within the folds of their life and their search a sense of strength and a reconstituted commitment to forge your own. And let us produce the next generation of occult Americans in light of the one that preceded us. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.